We're just going to move into the second session immediately before we have a break. And this again, you know, when I said in the beginning about the dragonfly and using both mental and emotional tools as the transformative tool, our second speaker this evening is Rita Banerji. She's a wildlife filmmaker, conservationist, and someone who's really been pioneering in the field. She's been working for more than 25 years and has won 3 Green Oscars. She's won the Prithvi Ratna. Just a couple of weeks ago, the Royal Bank of Scotland declared her an Earth Hero and awarded her for that from across the globe. But she has worked with wild elephants, with saving the whale shark. But most substantively now, she's been working in the Northeast, where she set up something called the Green Hub, which is a video documentation center and which grants fellowships to young people, many of them first-generation literate, from all the 8 states in the Northeast. And she has been training them to use the camera in a way to really balance not just conservation activities, but livelihood. Because one of the greatest conflicts of our time is not the conflicts that we speak of, you know, which is in the Northeast or in Kashmir, which is not to do with guns and battles and insurgencies, but the great battle between nature and man. We often forget that really economy itself is a subset of ecology. We look at it as something different, and the entire attempt to save nature is seen as the crusade of bleeding heart liberals. But Rita has found that great bridge through Green Hub, and through all these years on the field, she has really understood the core politics that underpins that how do you make communities themselves understand the value of nature and become collaborators and partners in seeking to save nature, not to create a new conflict between conservationists and development, the development agenda. So she's really got a huge body of work. And today, more than just in conversation, she's going to be doing a presentation which traces her work and traces the work of others that she has enabled and what are the lessons that she leaves with us to take back into our own lives. But before we call her on stage, I'd like to show you a small snippet of the sheer body of work that Rita Banerji has put in, and then we'll call her on stage.
Just to stand here is a privilege and makes you feel good. One reason I've come to Northeast India is because I was so impressed by what Green Hub is doing and wanted to learn what all they're doing and how they're doing it.
This is really the camera as a tool of absolute transformation, and the person who's enabling that, Rita Banerji. Please join me in welcoming her on stage.
Good evening, everybody. And actually, that was my entire presentation. So Thank you, Algebra, for inviting me. And I must say it's an honor to be in the presence of Ustad Shujat Khanji and Devdutt Patnaik. And I'm really happy to be here. If I talk about my journey, if I reflect back, I can safely say that filmmaking has been my biggest teacher. First as a camera person, then as a filmmaker, and then using video as a tool of change. It's been a fascinating journey, filming honey hunters in the Nilgiris, filming with traditional fish workers across the coast of India, filming with traditional healers in central India, filming with the indigenous communities in northeast India. It's been more than 20 years. It still feels like a beginning. I'm still hooked on. Before I move ahead, I'd like to share a clip of one of the films which he did. It's about the Amur Falcons. Can we play the clip, please? Well, when you're sitting for hours with your camera, you know, sitting on a spot just alone with hundreds of Amur falcons flying above you, it's a meditative moment. You just sit there. You can just keep sitting there watching the Amur falcons flying above you. This film was shot in 2013, the first year when the hunting of Amur falcons was banned. They used to be killed in thousands in Nagaland. And because of a video clip of some friends of mine, there are three people who shot the killing of Amur falcons. And that video clip led to the ban on the killing of Amur falcons. And 2013 is when we filmed that. And now if you go there are Amur falcons flying everywhere. There are moments like that in other places. I've spent nights on a little beach in Andamans, little Andamans, filming the leatherback, waiting for them to arrive on the beach. A moonlit beach, you're just waiting there, you're walking the beach, waiting for the leatherback to arrive. And when you see that, it's very, very, very difficult to, you know, imagine what happens. It's the peace, the silence, the happiness, what you experience. Nobody can take away the magic from that moment. I'll share that clip with you. This is in Little Andamans, a beach which is far away from human habitation. Yeah, can we play that clip, please?
On blue-rimmed islands, light and life could have been like it is for millions of years. When the tide, wind, and surf are aligned as required, a turtle arrives. A single halo of light brings us racing to this reptile with instincts longer than lifetimes. Going into labor, her eyelids open and shut, full of tear gel. She buries the fruits of her labor. Leatherbacks bring us closer to the depths connecting oceans to shorelines. Departures are clouded in the same mystery that drew their ancestors seaward during the time of dinosaurs.
Spent almost a month in this place, on this beach, which was far away from any human habitation. It took us 6 hours by boat to reach this beach. It's called West Bay. There's a whole research team which has been working on the leatherbacks for more than 5 years. In fact, one of the boys, Adit, he's from Chennai. He goes there every year, spends the entire season there following the leatherbacks. But the crazy thing is, you spend the whole night following the leatherbacks and you walk the beach in the morning, it's full of debris. There are Bisleri bottles, there are beer bottles, there are plastic cans. The entire beach is covered with debris. And there's nothing on that island which has created that debris. It's coming from all of us. At night, sometimes you have to pick up the Bisleri bottles while the leatherback is laying its eggs. So there's a whole other side. At one side, there are these magical moments. On the other side, there's a whole story happening. I've spent time filming many such moments. I followed an old woman walking miles to collect firewood so that she can sell it in the market the same day, come back, and feed her little grandkid. In that area, there were starvation deaths that year. I filmed a midday meal. We talk about the midday meal and about how important it is. I filmed a kid taking the dregs from the end of the vessel and not taking it for herself. It was for the little brother who was with her. So my learning about conservation, about India, is that moments which are moving between, oscillating between these magical moments to challenging moments. And that's where you keep questioning, what is conservation? What is livelihood? What is survival? These things are constantly running in your head. I'll share a clip now. This is happening across India right now, every part of India, Assam, Tamil Nadu, Karnataka. And it's a consequence of what we are doing to nature, what we are doing to cities. Can we play that clip, please?
We are all here. She's charging, eh? Matthew, come this side.
Come, Tara.
She's charging, eh? Matthew.
Well, this is a reality. There was one film, The Wild Meat Trail, which we filmed between 2002 to 2007. 5 years we spent filming in the Northeast. This film was called The Wild Meat Trail. And we were following the story of two orphan bear cubs and exploring why there are so many orphan bear cubs, and which led us to see that hunting is a big part of the Northeast tribal community. Not just the poaching, illegal poaching is a different network, while wild meat hunting is for food. And it's happened for generations, and what we wanted to explore was whether it had any impact on wildlife itself, whether it was sustainable, whether the wildlife was disappearing. It took us a long time, but why this film became very important to us was because this film is what led us to take the next step, which made us push beyond films and say, maybe films are not enough. Maybe we need to go beyond that. I'll just show a clip from that before we move ahead. Yeah.
Green vegetables, grain and wood come from their forest and their land. What they do not have is a source of cash to provide for their new needs. Fueled by the increasing demand for wild meat from cities across the northeast, hunting is turning into the primary source of cash for those who do not have access to other livelihood options. Wild meat is mostly transported by public transport and is a common commodity that finds its way to the marketplace. For 6,000 rupees, this deer has travelled from a faraway forest to the jeep of a government official. We are awed by the Northeast, by its dense forests teeming with wildlife and people living in tandem with nature. An idea difficult to reconcile with what lies before our eyes.
This film was in 2010 and it did well. It did well in festivals and everything, but I think it left within us a feeling that, can we go beyond that? I think we felt that it's time to work with the community. And could we have the PowerPoint now, please? Yeah. So this was during the filming of the Wild Meat Trail. This is a group of Nishi hunters. In fact, they had banned hunting in their village, and they had taken us to the forest. And it's not just a black and white thing of wild meat hunting. We get shocked by these images. But this is steeped in their culture, in their rituals, in their festivals. What is tipping the balance is that wild meat has a cash component to it. So this particular village had banned hunting, and we went with them, Shilpi, my colleague, and all. This is in the forest. And what we were left with was the incredible knowledge that they had while being in the forest. They would just go with a dao, nothing else. We camped there for a few nights, and just with a dao, they would set up camp, they would cut the cane and bamboo and make a little net for catching the fish. Nothing was carried from the village. Everything was created there. And it was one of those incredible journeys with them. It helped us to understand what was really happening and really pushed us to think about working in that area. And how this film really helped us was that little clip helped us to start a very small initiative in one of the villages of Nagaland called Chizami. And we started a education program called Under the Canopy. At that point, we just wanted to do something. We didn't know where we would go. We just wanted to do something. We wanted the children, the community, to really look at wildlife differently, to really look at a frog as part of the ecosystem, to look at the bird, look at the bees which are pollinating the crops. And every year we had 20 kids from the village. Parents were hunters, they themselves were hunters. And but through these sessions, there's a friend of mine, Payal, she's a wildlife educator, another friend called Maya. And through these sessions, they learned how to measure a tree. They were able to identify insects. They were able to understand what a butterfly does. And a whole new world opened up for these kids. This Sanjay Sondi, he has something called the Titli Trust and works not just in the Northeast. He's working in different parts of India. And what was really amazing to see was through the Eco Club, the entire village got involved because the village council was proud of their children now who were documenting the wildlife in their area. They were documenting the moths, they were documenting the butterflies, they were identifying moths, they were identifying birds, and it helped the entire village community to talk about conservation, talk about forests. And this is Alo, a local boy from that village. We had a training the trainers program so that after we moved out, they could carry on the work there. So Alo today, in fact, has become one of the butterfly experts from Nagaland and works with different groups, taking them to different parts of Nagaland. So these are all pictures which have been taken by the children, and they came out with small books, small haiku books, and newsletters, and even a small booklet called Butterflies of Chizami. Under the canopy and the Eco Club program went into other villages in Nagaland. It is still carrying on in small ways in a village, in a village called Fakim, and even in the place where we have the Amur falcons. But the thing was, against this backdrop, while this Eco Club initiative was great and it made us feel really good, what we saw across the Northeast was mining, illegal logging, which were at a much larger scale than any conservation initiative being done by any group. All groups put together could not, cannot, even today, fight what is happening. In the Northeast, the largest rate of deforestation is in the Northeast. In the last 20 years, we've lost more than 50% of our forest. So the thing was, how do we scale up conservation? How do we really make it a movement? The youth, we say the youth are going to be the future. The future is in their hands. How are we going to enable that future? How are we going to enable them to create that future? So Green Hub was formed with these thoughts. Can we create a platform where the youth could engage and empower themselves in looking at the forests, the rivers, the natural resources as their livelihood? Look at livelihood, sustainable livelihoods, by protecting the forests and not by destroying them. Green Hub was born with that idea. Video was our strength, and that's what we decided to use. So this is what Green Hub is. It's a youth and community-based fellowship, a video fellowship, and a documentation center. Every year, 20 fellows from across the Northeast states, are selected. It's quite an intensive process. We get applications. The focus is really on youth from remote areas, from marginalized communities, who cannot afford to do this kind of training, but are somewhere committed to working with conservation and social change, or are committed to working with their community. It's a difficult process. Sometimes we make mistakes, but we get amazing, amazing young minds who are the future now. It's a one-year fellowship. Once they join us, these 20 fellows are with us for 1 year. They learn how to video document, they learn how to storytell, they learn how to edit. And we have a lot of eminent people coming. Shekhar, in fact, is from Chennai, Shekhar Dattatri. He hasn't come there till now, but he has contributed in giving us material for the training manual. That's Gurmeet, who's an award-winning filmmaker. There's a whole consortium of resource people across India who come to Green Hub now. They engage with the youth. They're getting amazing training. Their skills are being developed. But the most important thing is, it's not that we are trying to create filmmakers. During the fellowship, they have to work with NGOs, they have to work with institutes, they have to go and document those stories on the ground. And that is what is opening their minds. They're seeing what is the reality on the ground, what are the solutions on the ground. When we talk about human-elephant conflict, they're actually going and seeing it. So this is Seetal. She's from the Nishi tribe in Arunachal. She doesn't know how to read or write, but she's working with Nature Conservation Foundation on hornbill conservation. And she uses a camera to tell the stories in the Tiger Reserve. This is Zakuma. He's part of the forest patrolling team in Dampa Tiger Reserve. Dampa Tiger Reserve is one of the most beautiful forest reserves in Mizoram, but the surrounding areas are becoming palm oil cultivations. There's a land use change, and palm oil cultivations are taking over all the surrounding areas of Dampa. So Zakuma, through his camera, is trying to bring those stories, trying to make his community aware that nothing can beat a forest. Nothing can beat what a forest gives you. These are some images from the training. They're not just filmmakers, but they're conservationists, they're experts from the field. And these are some images from the internship time. This is, in fact, Wanmay and Rehan. This is the first day. Greena was started in 2015. And the first day of internship is when we got an elephant right on the road. This is where they stayed while filming that. This was an elephant corridor which was being made by WTI so that the elephants could move freely between two sanctuaries. This is a very remote village, I was telling you, the Fakim village in Nagaland. These two are from our first batch. So it's at one level, the capacities of the youth are being built. At the other side, a lot of video documentation is happening. It's not just conservation. We are not looking at conservation as an isolated subject, where when you talk about environment, it has to be the forest and it has to be the wildlife. But conservation, when you're talking about conservation, it's an umbrella. I think it links up with each of our lives, whether it's water, whether it's air, whether it's pollution. So the kind of stories which we are covering covers a whole gamut. It covers the village stories, SHG groups, community conservation, women and environment. And what it's doing is it's building a whole video resource of material which is not just limited to the Northeast. It's going into institutes, we are collaborating with universities, we are collaborating with schools, we are going into community screenings. And so really, really creating a base so that this education model can really transform the way people think about environment. These are some of the images from the community screenings. This is one of the fellows, Chentai from Nagaland, that's his grandmother. He had made a film on the revival of millets, and the film featured her. So he took the film back, put it on his phone, and this is the kind of community screenings we've had. And it's a very participatory process because they give a feedback and the Chentai comes back, readers of film, goes back into the field. So yes, many new things are happening, emerging from the fellows itself. But one of the things is that yes, we have created a fellowship, but is it making any difference? And that's where our alumni, the stories of our alumni becomes important. So today we have a network of 55 fellows across the Northeast. We are in our fourth year. This is Genesis 4. There are four fellows from four different states, Nagaland, Assam, Arunachal, and Meghalaya. Now, when you talk of the Northeast, it's very unique because we only think of conflict and violence. So one of the things which GreenUp, in a very organic way, is doing is trying to break these barriers of borders, barriers of language, trying to get everybody together. So maybe 10 years later, this network of fellows across the Northeast states can bring something together. Now, I'd like to share a film which has been made by Genesis 4. They're making a film on the Bugun Leochiklia, which is an endangered bird. Now, till now you've seen clips which we've done. These clips have been done entirely by the fellows. Can you please play that clip?
What strikes me is that the fact that such a colorful and such a distinctively audible bird remained unknown to science till 2006 when it was first described. The entire global range of the Bugulio chicla is only a few square kilometers. We would be very worried that some accidental epidemic or some human act can completely can make this bird go extinct. So in that sense, we want to understand what is special about this place. It requires research. It requires resources to carry out the research. But at the end of the day, since the numbers, known numbers are so small that we can't do the kind of research that we would do with a more common bird. That's one of the problems in trying to understand more about the biology of the Leo chicla.
So before I end, the hope is that this network of fellows, this network of youth, will actually do conservation activities on the ground, will try and bring our forests back, will try and bring our rivers back, will help to build the region back. And I'd like to end with one promo, which is made every year by a group of fellows at the end of the session. Can we just play that clip? Yeah. No, can we play the next one? I think we are running short of time, that's why.
That was Rita Banerji, and as she said, they've created a network of 55 fellows. They're always looking for funding, so if you want to help, of course, you can go to GreenHub, www.greenhub.com, or to any of the fellows that they've created to help their conservation projects as well.